All right. Hello and welcome to the City Club of Cleveland. I'm Dan Malthrop. I'm the chief executive here at the City Club. Welcome to all of you for this inaugural event in our Art by Design series. 5 years ago, most of us had never heard of James Corner. And most of us, if we gave much thought to Public Square at all, didn't imagine any sort of redesign was in the offing. It's sort of amazing how much can change in 5 short years. In January of 2010, our speaker this evening, James Corner, came to Cleveland to share some ideas with an audience at the Levin College of Urban Affairs at Cleveland State University. At the time, Corner was emerging on the national stage as the visionary talent that made a reality out of a dream of a park on an old, unused elevated railway in New York City. That park, the High Line, is now one of Manhattan's most popular destinations for New Yorkers and tourists alike, and has spawned what must be billions of dollars in private development along its 20 blocks. Although, I may be exaggerating. I'm not exaggerating. Billions. Back in early 2010, James Corner came to Cleveland specifically to share 3 big ideas for Public Square. The specifics of those big ideas aren't nearly as important as what they did for the community. They helped us all imagine a future that we couldn't really see on our own, a future that put all of the public back in Public Square, to enjoy the space, to lie on the grass, to play chess, to splash in a fountain, to read a book, hear music, to meet a friend for a picnic lunch, to catch a bus, to walk, or perhaps to hear a speaker on a summer afternoon. In these intervening years between 2010 and now, as a community, we have studied the plans, narrowed down the big ideas, gathered input from stakeholders across the community, studied the plans some more, and then studied them some more, and then begun raising tens of millions of dollars, which are required to make these big ideas our big reality. Many people have been working very hard to help us get to this point. In no particular order, as a community, we should collectively thank the Group Plan Commission, the Greater Cleveland Partnership, the Downtown Cleveland Alliance, Land Studio. Back then, they were just Parkworks and CPA. The City of Cleveland, Cuyahoga County, the Greater Cleveland RTA, the Office of Councilman Joe Simperman, and many others, including many of you here today. Another important partner in all of this is Cuyahoga Arts and Culture, our sponsor tonight and a funder of some of those very partner organizations. This evening, we're very pleased to welcome James Corner of James Corner Field Operations, the architect of the proposed Public Square redesign, and he will share the latest in the collaboratively created vision for Public Square. Our goals tonight are to illuminate this vision for all of us, to get your questions answered, to get feedback and input from all of you as well. To that end, we'll have a Q&A in the second half of our program, and there are comment cards you can use, or you can go online to groupplan.org. And also a heads up to all of you joining us via broadcast. We're anticipating this event is going to run longer than an hour, but we'll have all of it on the web afterwards as well. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming James Corner.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here in this esteemed club. It's a little intimidating to see the photographs of everyone that's spoken here over the decades, the many presidents and important people. But I guess in our own little way, we're doing something very important here today. We're talking about the heart and soul of Cleveland and what we can do to sort of reinvigorate Public Square as that new symbolic center for the people of Cleveland. I'm standing here, but really I represent a big team for this effort. All of the Cleveland representatives that were just mentioned, but I would like to single out Ann Zola with Land Studio at the back. And in my own office, my partner Richard Kennedy has really been heading this up on a daily basis, and we have a number of local representatives here. If anyone of them is here on our design team, please just raise your hand. I don't know if we have representatives, but we are a sort of diverse team with engineering and horticulture and public art, and so we are a team, and we've been working on this for 5 years now, and 5 years ago we came forward with 3 schemes. They were intended to be very provocative, intended really to provoke a discussion, and I believe that that's another tradition in this city club. It's a place of free speech, So I'm told to expect an onslaught of opinion and commentary, and that's welcome. That's what Public Square should be about. And what those three original projects were about provoking a discussion. And as a result of that, these number of years later, we've got to the design that we now have, that I think is a very robust and exciting vision for moving Public Square forward. Just to sort of say something a little more orienting for our discussion is the importance of this sort of project in cities around the country. Cleveland is competing with many other cities for tourists, for residents, for businesses, for all of the tax dollars that brings. And you need growth, and you need the tax dollars to support the schools and to support the police and to do all of the things that a city has to do. And one of the things that cities are reinvesting in a bid to retain their competitive edge is the public realm. Think of Millennium Park in Chicago, for example. Once a parking lot, transformed into a massive new park at considerable expense, but using a lot of private philanthropic money. It's now become a centerpiece for Chicago. No one goes to Chicago without going to Millennium Park. This particular feature is wonderful. It combines public art with placemaking, with interactivity with water. It's very popular with families and with children, and people return to it again and again. And it has really facelifted this part of Chicago. You know that my office worked on the design of the High Line in New York, a dilapidated, rundown, 1.5 mile elevated railroad structure. Many people wanted it pulled down. They saw it as being derelict, abandoned, filled with rats and drug dealers and dark hidden corners for crime. And a neighborhood group got together to paint a different picture, to paint a picture that maybe this could be a positive asset. And indeed, Mayor Bloomberg invested in it as part of a revitalization effort, an economic revitalization effort for that part of the city, and reinvested in this new High Line design as a new elevated promenade with a series of gardens and magnificent vistas across the city. The important part about both these projects, Millennium Park and the High Line, and a number of other public space projects around the country, is the importance the design plays for people. It's not simply about making the place beautiful and scenic. It's about creating settings where people want to be, that attracts people, that makes them go out of their way to go to that place. And once they're in that place, they want to be part of the scene. All these images here just show people simply lounging. It's a really simple activity. People go to public places to stroll, but also to just sit and to take in the scene. Part of why we all love to live in cities is to be with other people and just watch other people and sort of take in the spectacle of that. There's also a little bit of exhibitionism in lounging. People too like to be seen, and they too like to be part of the scene. The way in which we're thinking about Public Square is to think about how to design it in a way that attracts people of diverse backgrounds, diverse ages, diverse interests, diverse orientations, and creates a truly public scene where people can watch other people and themselves be part of the scene. We believe in children as being, you know, in a sort of sentimental way, you can say that we're designing Public Square for the next generation, for children. But also great parks are attractive and appealing to children, and they're particularly appealing to families. Families will make an afternoon of a trip to come to Public Square because it's cool for the children to be a part of. These baskets that you see here in the illustration, these are pavilion baskets we designed for a park in Santa Monica. They're on hilltops that we created on an otherwise flat parking lot. They raise people 25 feet above that original datum. They now get magnificent views to the pier and to the ocean, and people are now themselves framed within these pavilions. They become theatrical stage set pieces for how people want to be in this park. Simply providing generous seating and allowing people to sit comfortably and to sit in various configurations, both in the shade and in the sun. The importance of food in public spaces, a place to buy a coffee, to buy an ice cream, to buy a sandwich. The possibility for public spaces hosting performance and being a place where people can be theatrical in both an impromptu sense and in an organized sense in terms of performances and concerts and community events, a place where people feel that they can have a community market or a community weekend. The possibilities for public art in the centerpiece of Cleveland, in Cleveland's new public square, the capacity for artists to participate in the life of the square. The occasions when the square could be closed down to all traffic and opened for rolling attractions, for festivals and markets, for carousels, for evening movies, for wintertime ice skating. The total visitation on the High Line in 2012 was recorded at 4.5 million people. That made it the second most visited tourist attraction in New York City after the Metropolitan Museum. And it has raised, Mayor Bloomberg loves to sort of quote that it did cost $150 million, not all of it in private money, some of that in philanthropic money, but he loves the equation of over $2 billion in new economic development, 29 major development projects, new buildings, new residents and new businesses, 12,000 new jobs, including heightened business activity in galleries and restaurants and cafes that were existing before that have now seen their business quintuple or more, new hotel rooms and new office space. And we see that the revitalization of Public Square, but also part of the group plan, Public Square in relationship to the mall and to the new bridge connecting these public spaces and the city to the lake. These are significant investments that aren't only beautifying, aren't only socially enriching and socially enhancing, but also will boost the economy of the city, if not the region, because they will be places that attract people, attract tourists and conventioneers who spend money and make the whole thing tick. The secret to the design is trying to capitalize on the size of Public Square. Building face to building face, it's nearly 10 acres. And yet, the four quadrants that are there now add up to a little over 4 acres of park space. We want to switch that around and actually have over 5 acres of park space, 5.2 acres of park space, by closing Ontario and reducing the width of Superior, and therefore making the park feel like a contiguous, unified whole, as opposed to separated quadrants. This image here that you're looking at is those two halves of the park now, overlaid on New York's Bryant Park. If any of you have been to Bryant Park, it's a hugely successful and very beautiful and large feeling park. It's equivalent in size to what we're proposing at Public Square. And you see in these images the diverse range of uses that occur in Bryant Park, the expansive lawn, people sitting in the shade of trees with movable tables and chairs, sometimes evening cinema, fashion shows, ice skating in the winter, yoga and community events in the space. A much smaller project, but an important project in Detroit, is Campus Martius, for those of you that know it. It's only 1.6 acres. It's much smaller than even one half of what we're doing in Public Square. And yet Campus Martius has really helped to revitalize that part of Detroit. They've done it through programming, active programming with food and coffee, with a space that can be fenced off for activities, including a roller rink in the summer, an ice rink in the winter, with simple plantings, simple furnishing. This space has been transformed. But the point I want to make with regards to Campus Martius and Bryant Park, and the High Line for that point, is the importance of programming. Creating a place that can be programmed actively for people to be invited in to do different things at different times. This is an aerial view looking at the park today. You're looking sort of southwest. The terminal tower is in the upper left-hand corner. And overlaid on that now with these two red lines is the extent of the two new parks. And you can see that Ontario is closed, Superior, presently at 77 feet from curb to curb, is reduced to 44 feet. We now have these two sides, each at 2.6 acres. This is the overall rendering, or the overall impression then, of the new park overlaid on that design. This new park does several important things urbanistically. First, it connects diagonally the transit center and the transit hub and terminal tower, diagonally connected across to the mall and to the key tower. So you have this strong diagonal gesture across the park. Secondly, we keep all view lines and all vista lines open and set back any tree planting so that the monuments are very clearly visible on these axial lines. So Euclid has a very clear vista to the Soldier and Sailor Monument. We pull the trees back so that that monument can stand very grand and very special in that location. We locate the Tom Johnson Monument and the Moses Cleveland statue so that they are axial on Ontario. And we open the corners of the park so that the park is invited, people are invited into the park from all corners and from all sides. What you see here in the plan, then, are the two sides of the park, if you will. On the north side is a green lawn. It's sculpted so that it tilts to face south, so that it captures all of that sunlight at lunchtime. And people will sit on the lawn and bathe in the sun. And on the other side is a urban plaza featuring the Soldiers and Sailors Monument, the water feature, and a new café. In this diagram, it's a little technical, shouldn't really show it in a public audience, but the point is this is going across the square, and it's showing how the two halves of the park interconnect. And you'll see that the black line is actually grading down, and that's what happens in this park. On the north side of the park is lower than the south side. And so what we do with the lawn is we raise the lawn up to raise that portion of the park. Looking at this section, you can see the two ears of the lawn are raised up. They are raised up to shape and enclose the park, and also to create inclined lawns that are free-draining, gentle enough for picnic cloths and for people to sit, but now really orienting people to the sun and to the views. You see in this diagram that the two halves, the lawn and the plaza, are shaped and then ringed by this white ribbon. The white ribbon crosses Superior. So what we're saying is that while Superior will be open to buses most of the time, Superior can also be closed at certain times, at weekends and at certain holidays. And therefore, this white ribbon becomes a figure that makes the park feel like one big 5-acre park, and you sort of take away the sense of the road. You see in this view, too, the lawn shaping the northern part of the park, the urban plaza on the southern part of the park. These are some view renderings now. And what I think is really nice about these is that they describe how the park is welcoming and inviting people in on those diagonals. So as you're approaching the park from the northeast here you're looking southwest to Terminal Tower. The diagonal sight line goes right through the park. And you can see the way the earth is sculpted and the planting is shaped, that you are drawn into the park, you're invited in, and your sight line is very clear going on the diagonal through. We also furnish those edges. So there are places, very generous benches all the way around these openings where people can sit. In this particular location next to Key Tower, there's a coffee shop and a restaurant. People will feel that it's really easy and welcoming to simply step across and come and sit on these benches and have a coffee or a sandwich and take in the scene. As you get a little closer, you see that the plantings on this edge, all of the edge is richly planted. It's not simply lawn. These are planted with tall grasses and perennials and shrubs and trees that bring seasonal variety and a quality of texture and a quality of the horticultural to the perimeter of the park. This is another entrance on the northwest now. You're sort of seeing the same principle played out here with a welcoming entrance, lots of places to sit, and gardens and horticulture on the perimeter. And as you get closer, you can see that people are very clearly visible inside the park. Again, another cue that welcomes people inside. This is a view that once you step inside now, the first thing you experience are a series of gardens. These pathways bring you into the larger area, which is the lawn and the plaza. But just before you step onto the lawn or the plaza, you're brought through a series of paths through a series of gardens. These gardens are intended to have a variety of tall grasses and perennials, some evergreens for the winter, lots of things that will have a strong springtime presence in April and June, and others that will have a strong presence in the fall and stay through the winter. We will recommend that these plantings do not get cut back in the fall, but they're allowed to stay in the winter so that they have their texture and their presence is there all winter long. And then they get cut back the first week of April, and then within a week, the green is coming back again. And you can see as you get close, there's again lots of seating and lots of places where people can feel comfortable inside these gardens. And this is just an example of some of the planting palette that will color the gardens. The ribbon is designed as this stone path that creates this figure, this figural loop around the whole park. We see it as a sort of promenade. We want to pave it in a granite block, so it will have a really beautiful texture and a really high quality. And it's a place where we hope that people will feel comfortable and invited to stroll around the ribbon and stroll around the park. If they don't do the full loop, anybody taking a diagonal will take the diagonal across this loop. So it will become peopled with people moving. And again, there's generous furnishing and lighting and planting all the way along this ribbon. The ribbon itself is sculpted three-dimensionally, which means that curbs and precast concrete seating elements are designed into the paving. So it's not just a paving pattern, it's also a surface that sculpts into a three-dimensional form. And it shapes all of these places as you walk around the park. So for example, in the top right here is Overlook Hill. This is a raised part of the lawn where you'll get raised views across the entire park. If you keep going around the path, you'll go into a series of gardens and the Moses Cleveland statue, which is on axis with Ontario and on axis to the courthouse. You keep going around to the Concert Hill. That's the sloped lawn, southwest exposure to the sun. You come over to the Soldiers and Sailors Monument on the right-hand part of the slide, through a series of gardens, the Tom Johnson statue, and some steps that we call the Speaker's Terrace, and out to the planter bench outside of Terminal Tower. So this ribbon, with its beautiful paving and its sculptural edges, becomes a really definitive feature. It has a high design quality in that it will be unusual and will look really beautiful. But most important, it's intended to be the primary pathway, the primary promenade, along which people stroll and sit and watch the city going by. You can see in these images just some of the craft that goes into how the details are made. How curbs turn into seating benches and turn into steps and turn into ramps. This park, by the way, is 100% ADA compliant and accessible to all people. And here you see how the ribbon works with Superior. So that instead of Superior being treated with concrete or asphalt as a typical street, this paved ribbon of granite block goes across the street. We will probably have to have a small curb, but it won't be a big typical curb. And again, the idea is that when you close Superior to traffic, it can begin to support festivals and markets and events and make the park feel contiguous as one. We are aware of the difficult winters here and the stress on pavement material. This is designed to the highest of engineering standards. We have a huge structural sub-base, and then we're using the highest quality granite and the highest quality materials to ensure that this is a durable and long-lasting surface. This is an example of the same materials that we're using in another cold city in Stockholm. And you can see the use of these stones create a very beautiful and cool surface feeling, basically the same material used in different details. This diagram on the left shows the park when the Superior is open to buses. And on the right, you see what happens when it's closed. And what that means is that when Superior is closed, you can see in this image, it lends itself to lines of tents, to market stands, to festival displays, to rolling attractions like carousels or traveling circuses to be set up in this space. And flanking that space then is the plaza and the lawn where people can gather and look into this space. Just a little bit more description on the lawn. You can see now how the lawn is sculpted by the ribbon. You have the Moses Cleveland statue right on axis with Ontario and the courthouse. Those two ears of the lawn are tilted up slightly. The one that we call Concert Hill has a series of ledges cut into it that will support seating, and you're facing the sun and Terminal Tower. You can see the gardens here with the little pink trees. Those are intended to be cherries and dogwoods and redbuds, which are really all beautifully flowering things in the springtime, and underneath them are the shrubs and the trees. Those lend a sense of enclosure to this lawn, so that when you are on the lawn, you feel that you're in a park. You don't feel that you're surrounded by streets. This is another view, just looking at the figuration of that lawn, and a view as if you're sitting now on those seated steps in Concert Hill, looking out to Terminal Tower. A little bit more of a close-up view there. You see the scale of the lawn. We see people sitting here to eat lunch. We see families. We see frisbee. We see picnic cloths. We also see the possibility of a temporary stage and performance. And at nighttime, the possibility for outdoor cinema. These are temporary inflatable movie screens that are put up temporarily. You can show a picture. This is the other part of that lawn where we have some shade trees, which are important for shade and where people can find a respite on a hot day. The other portion of the park is the plaza. This is really, again, a beautiful stone surface. There are three components. In yellow is a café pavilion, movable tables and chairs outside. In the center is a water feature. It's primarily a beautiful civic water feature, but it's also designed to be interactive. You can step into the water and play with it. And on the other hand is the Soldiers and Sailors Monument that's now really open, highly visible, treated very respectfully, given more space and given more presence in the context of the park. This is a sort of a sketch with the Soldiers and Sailors Monument on your left, looking to the Terminal Tower on the right. The water feature is designed to be just about a half inch of water on a surface. There's no edge to this water feature. It has no rim. It means when you turn the water feature off, you have a perfectly flat urban plaza. You can turn the water feature off, and you can have the plaza for tents or for circuses or for events. In winter, you can set up an ice skating facility on this plaza. When you turn the water on, it creates a skin of water, just half an inch. Very reflective, reflects the sky and it reflects the buildings around. And at nighttime, it will reflect all of the ambient light from the adjacent buildings. Because it's so shallow, you can walk in it. Most people on a hot day might choose to take their shoes and socks off, as in the top right image there. But you can see the child there with the shoes. You're also able to stroll through in this with shoes on too. This is an example of this kind of water effect. This is a project in France, but the first image I showed you in Millennium Park is exactly the same treatment of a film of water on a stone surface, reflecting the sky and reflecting everything around it and allowing you to walk through it. This is our sort of rendering. You're looking on axis north to the courthouse here. Key Tower is on the right in this view. You can see this ellipse of inky, silky, reflective water in the center of the square. We're also designing it so that jets will come on from time to time, and the jets will be what we call dynamic or sculptural. That is to say that the jets will actually create shapes as certain jets are programmed to come on and to turn off. And these are very successful things with children in particular, because they will like to run around and run through the different arches and the different patterns that are made in this dynamic fountain. When the fountains are off, it's a silky ink reflective surface. When the fountains are on, it becomes something much more fun and engaging. And at nighttime, we have a lighting program so that the water itself conducts the light and becomes a lit feature, a lit centerpiece, very clearly visible from all the streets around the park and from all of the corners, as something that is a civic symbol of the heart of this park and something you can all be proud of. In winter, that plaza can be converted to an ice skating facility. They did this at Campus Martius, as I illustrated before, in Detroit. We can do one here that's probably twice as big as that and could be a real centerpiece. We also show a Christmas tree set in the center of the park here. But the idea is that through, again, creative programming, the park lends itself to creative uses and creative programs, even in the darkest winter weeks and months. And we see, again, that the way the planting is designed and the sculptural properties will be an attractive park in winter time. So that's the water feature in the central part. On the other part is this, with this yellow figure you see here, is the café pavilion. We see this as a place to simply get a cup of coffee and a small sandwich. We see lots of movable tables and chairs. This is where people can make themselves comfortable as an individual or as a couple or as a group and simply take in the scene and have a coffee and a sandwich. This is located right outside Terminal Tower where most people will be coming and going. So it's sort of a prime location. And on the other side is the Soldiers and Sailors Monument. We really think this is a beautiful monument. It's got an impressive scale to it. It's an important story, what the monument represents. We think that by opening up the space around it so the monument can be more visible and have more presence is important. And we also propose to light it such that it's a dramatically lit sculptural element at nighttime. Lighting is also important throughout the entire park for safety and for the park to have a vibrant nighttime presence. So that summarizes my presentation. I think we're very excited about this park. I think it will transform the heart of Cleveland. In a sense, it's an update of what Public Square always aspired to be, which was the commons and the centerpiece for everybody that lives in this city to come. It is a park that we believe will function well in everyday use with just commuters and office workers and people coming and going. It will function well at weekends with families, and it will function really well on holidays when you can close Superior and host major civic events and major civic festivals. So it works from the everyday to the special and to the civic. It is a park that is designed around people. We've put people first. It's about pathways where people can stroll through gardens with ample seating, with exposure to sunlight and shade, and exposure to other people, which is why we're all in this room together, to be with other people, to see what's going on. And that's what I hope Public Square will all be about. Thank you. I forgot to mention schedule. We're actually very advanced, where the design is quite developed, such that we've been able to get cost estimates and review technical details. This is a timely moment with a public forum where we want to get your input and feedback. The design is still a work in progress. And then through the rest of the summer, we will be developing the technical drawings, which will be bid to contractors to build the park, with, we hope, groundbreaking as early as this fall and with an opening in the spring of 2016. So that's the plan moving forward. Great. Thank you.
Let's just make sure. So I've got a couple of questions. I think the most important thing, though, is to open up to questions from all of you who are here. One of the things that we didn't hear a lot about, I'm glad you included a rendering that had snow in it. I was worried for a second, and that's important to all of us here. But public transportation is probably for those of us that have been following the development of this, it's one of those points of tension in this design and in any design of any public space. Particularly, our public square is used by a lot of transit riders. How are you thinking about that? Tell us a little bit more about what you're thinking about there.
Well, I view it quite positively. I mean, I think transit is a means of making sure people are there.
It delivers to your customers.
It's not just office buildings and the occasional shopper. There's actually a lot of coming and going. So I would view transit very, very positively as something that actually helps to animate the park with people coming and going, all sorts of people. I think that's important for a public space to be open and inviting to all. And we are looking at, we're presently doing a study to look at where exactly the transit stops and transit shelters and transit hubs should be and how it can all work with adjacent buildings, adjacent properties, and the adjacency of the park.
Will you be doing some drawings that include, the kind of, I mean, you talked about the building elements sort of seamlessly growing into seating and things like that. Will there also be elements that seamlessly grow into bus shelters?
The budget is such that we have to reuse the bus shelters, correct? Yeah.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Just unless anybody wants to. Yeah. Jeremy? No?
Well, unless okay. Someone wants to write a check for bus
right,
shelters.
For bus shelters. Okay. Just curious about that. What? How has this process been for you? You're very much a process person, I know, and this has been a long project so far. I expect much of what you work on is typically. Nothing gets done quickly.
Yeah. But
how has this, what have you learned about Cleveland as you've been going through this process? And what has really, I'm curious to know about, this is such an asset that you have, like sort of our crown jewel in a lot of ways. And I'm curious to know how you're thinking about it has evolved over the last 5 years?
I don't know. It's a good question. I think I've been impressed overall with the aspiration of almost everybody we've met. And we've met civic leadership at the highest level of civic leadership here in Cleveland, and we've met regular people who are just interested in what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. And the aspirations are really, really high and really positive, and that's not always true. Now, I know there are blogs, and I know there are negative cynics on the blogs that are skeptical about this sort of investment in public space or even the value of public space today. But they're few and far between. I mean, I meet a lot more positive, aspirational, and ambitious people at all levels than I do the cynics, which is a good and fresh thing.
That is good. I imagine you've spent some time with the history of the place, too. It's from the founding, as you mentioned, the commons, the original commons, where people would bring their cattle and their sheep to graze, to what it's become today, which, as you pointed out, is a majority of space given over to four-wheeled modes of transportation. What about the history has sort of struck with you through this design process that you've tried to pull back to our future?
Well, it's a good question. I don't know if I have a great answer except
that. Well, if you haven't been looking at the history, then we're
still. Well, no, we've definitely been looking at the history and been most impressed with the fact that it was once a very, very simple commons. I mean, it was almost like a New England commons. Yeah. So there was no pretension. No accoutrements, no frills. In fact, old historic ink pen drawings just show it as like a field you would put cattle in with a sort of wooden fence and gate around the whole thing. But it was an important symbolic civic center where people, democracy, could play out in its most open and uninhibited way. This is different from a lot of public spaces in, say, Europe where, you know, there are a lot of frills. There's a lot of attention paid to design with a big D, mm-hmm. where you're sort of making the place as a sort of status symbol to represent something about that city or about that place. It becomes representational. Mm-hmm. And what I like about the original public square, but I believe also what we're doing, is it's less about representation and stature and grandeur, and it's a lot more about people. And we're hoping to restore, you know, the idea that this is not just a park, it's not just a plaza, it is public square. It's for people, it's for free speech, it's for exposure to others, it's for civic events and activities. That I think is what ties this current design into the original intention for public square to be the heart of the city.
Having said that, we should open the floor to the public. If anybody, I'm going to keep asking questions until somebody steps to the microphones. So don't be shy. Go ahead. Thank you. All right. Our first question. And remember, it doesn't have to be just a question. This is the one moment when you can actually just state a comment at the City Club of Cleveland.
On the perimeter of the park, are there any plans in your designs to include a bicycle-friendly area with bicycle racks?
That's a detail. Do we have bicycle racks? We do. Yeah. I mean, just philosophically, I'm all for it. I mean, moving more towards a city that's about people, that's about walkability, that's about bicycles. You know, that's the direction we should be moving in, and we have allowed for the accommodation of that.
Good evening. I'm not sure. Can you go back one slide? I had a question about one of the renderings. There you go, right there. So my question is, in the bottom portion of that paragraph, or in that picture, there's a photo of a public transit bus and a series of pylons, looks like, and then there's a car there. That's my question is, number one, what are those pylons? Number two, how will you prevent cars from driving down the middle of that lane? How do you limit it to just buses? How are you going to, is it wayfinding? Is it signage? Is it lighting? How do you preserve
on
that?
On Superior?
Correct.
Well, there's a number of devices. There's obviously clear signage. What's called tactile marking, which means that the surface of the road will have a coarse texture in it, which is another demarcation. And we're exploring whether or not to retain a curb or to use bollards as part of demarcation of the street. So there's a number of techniques that are common in transportation planning and design, street design, that we're using here to sort of signal, A, this is a primarily pedestrian zone, it's part of the park, B, it's bus lanes only, and C, it can easily be closed off.
So in this particular scenario, that car is errant, I guess, that's not...
the little red car is an error.
He's about to get a ticket, I guess.
you've
Thanks.
I'm looking at my guys over there.
That was just that was there to see if anybody was paying attention, I think, right? So great.
You know,
we
were in Seattle last week, working on Seattle's Central Waterfront, massive public project and public interest. We were told to by the client several times to make sure that the people in our renderings look like they're from Seattle. So,
what does that mean?
Well, somebody in my office, either mistakenly or knowingly, put Amanda Knox front and center.
Awesome.
In one of those renderings, and now we're in trouble for it. So, you know, renderings take on a life of their own.
Yeah.
You get people in them that shouldn't be in them, and you get sometimes a car that shouldn't be there. Yeah.
But well, I think as long as
we'll
it's
correct that.
As long as it's an American-made car, I'm sure many in the audience will be fine.
My name is Ellen Connolly, and I'm president of the Cuyahoga County Council. And I don't want to be a naysayer, but I want to make it clear to everyone here that that quadrant of the square where the Soldiers and Sailors Monument is located belongs to the county. We have a Supreme Court decision from 1898, which is actually very interesting to read. We own from curb to curb. And the members of the Soldiers and Sailors Monument and members of the County Council are very concerned about preserving the heritage of that monument, and we are not necessarily just going to give up our land from curb to curb. So I think there has to be an additional dialogue. I know someone from the Soldiers and Sailors Monument met with some of your people today, but we want to make sure that we had damage to it this weekend. Someone was up on and, you know, broke some of our cannons or whatever. So I just want to make sure that everyone understands that's our quadrant. We have to protect that monument and the historical heritage of it. And we really want to work with you, but you just can't come and, you know, move our stuff.
No, we understand that. We love the monument. We're big fans of the monument. We met with some of the team on your side today, and I believe there's another meeting scheduled in July. And we want to work with you, and we want to make sure that the monument remains front and center and is treated with respect.
It's the largest Civil War monument in the nation.
Yeah.
And it really has great significance, and I would encourage everyone to stop in and see it.
Yeah. Agreed.
Go ahead.
I have two questions. I was wondering if you could discuss, like, how... and great plan, by the way. How you can, if you could discuss, like, how you are addressing the view down Ontario to the county courthouse, which was planned, you know, as part of when they did the mall. So making sure that that vista is still, like, maybe even made better by from the park or from Public Square. And then also, have you guys thought about how the park meets the buildings, that's really kind of like one room? So instead of it feeling like an island with cars circulating around it, even though you still have the car traffic, it still feels like in Europe, you know how there's no curbs really, it just goes to the building, and so it feels like one big space. If you could discuss those two things, thank you.
Well, with regards to the Ontario access and the access to the courthouse, I mean, I think we're really framing that access in a subtle way. The lawn is sculpted down, so at its lowest point is the access to the courthouse. So we're framing it. We've put the Moses Cleveland statue there and the Tom Johnson statue on the southern flank, and we've taken out the street trees on that axis. So you have a very clear line of sight, whether you're looking north or south, along the Ontario axis. And yet, you know, we don't need to do anything more than that, I think. The two monuments mark the ends, the courthouse is there, the sight lines are open, and the topography of the land is framing the vista. With regards to meeting the buildings, I mean, again, most of our budget and most of our scope is on the interior of the park. So, I mean, I think we're meeting the buildings less in a material way with curbs and pavement and more in a sightline sort of way, that these paths and axes and diagonals have very clear sightlines to all the major building entrances. We sort of have given the church a little bit of a garden in front of it. We've got a big seating area in front of Key Tower. We've got the café pavilion in front of Terminal Tower. So there's a number of things going on inside the park that respond to the buildings. But we're a little limited with scope and budget for actually going further to the building face itself.
So then just to follow up on that, so is the city going to work to make sure that the area from the building, you know, to the park feels, you know, maybe there's just a crosswalk that has brick in it or something so that you feel like you're connected to Public Square, even if you're on the other side of the street?
Well, have we modified crosswalks, Rich?
Crosswalks are all into the corner and crossing the area from east
and west. So let me just repeat that so everybody could hear. Crosswalks are incorporated into the design at all the major intersections and major spots.
Thank you.
All right. Another question.
Hi there. So Cleveland is recently marking the last burning of the Cuyahoga River, which is pretty exciting because we've cleaned up the river, we've cleaned up our lakefront, and this is a showcase project, and one thing that we can continue to work on is our stormwater management in the city. Are there any stormwater features included in this design? Are you using permeable pavers, rain gardens, anything like that?
Well, the sculptural quality of the lawn allows all of the water in the northern part of the park to be collected. We're exploring subterranean cisterns, which would collect all of that water and allow that water to leak back into the groundwater naturally. And on the plaza side, we're collecting water. Some of it, just because of volume, is being siphoned into the system. But a large part of it's being used in the planting beds. So we are trying to be as sustainable and as responsible as we can with regards to water and urban habitat.
I think it's a magnificent design, very thoughtful, and while we understand that the county owns the Soldier and Sailors Monument, and which has been very thoughtfully and well renovated recently, I think that all of us regard the park as all of ours and not a turf war. So I particularly appreciate your respectful approach to dealing with that. Two questions for you. One is, you've spoken about constraints as relates to budget. Can you share with us what the budget is and where the sources of the funds are? But more importantly, if you had more money, do you have other aspirations? The question is begged, is there more that you would like to see accomplished by what is it that you've started out, and is there potential even after this is realized for that vision to continue to be realized?
I have to interrupt before you answer that. What a great cliffhanger question to invite our broadcast audience to go to the web, cityclub.org. You'll find it there. We've got to end the broadcast program right now. We should actually have a round of applause to end the broadcast program. And now for your answer. How much did you say it was going to cost again?
Well, it's a $30 million budgeted park, and in our current cost estimate, we're a hair over that, but we'll bring it to within $30 million, and that's what we are designing to, and that's the budget. Could we do more with more? Yes. I know there's various philanthropic efforts that are afoot, and there may indeed be more money coming, and if that happens, that's great. But we're designing the park, and everything I've shown you is designed for the $30 million that we have. Does anyone want to add anything?
Tony Coyne, do you? Okay. To identify yourself if you would, please.
Yeah, Tony Coyne, I'm chairman of the Group Plan Commission. I want to thank several of our fellow commission members are here for this particular program too. The overall project is $60 to $65 million, but that includes public square enhancements to our existing malls, which have really been terrifically restored and transformed in my view, and then a very important pedestrian connection to our lakefront. So all put together, that involves $60 to $65 million for the enhancements, the capital improvements. We hope we'll set aside some of that funding for maintenance as well as some for programming, but those are pretty much the items, and Mr. Corner's right on the mark. $30 million is our goal and our budget. Anyone who wants to contribute, please see me after the program.
This is a great plan, and I run the hotel that's right on the quadrant there, the Renaissance. And here's my question. When we go into the actual construction phase, who will put some thought into the sleeping guests that are going to be on that side of the building? And I know it's funny, but it's true. So I'd love to be able to meet whoever's going to be in that kind of planning, because I know that this is probably going to be really loud. And the second question that I have is that you know, putting the cafe right in front of the building as well, that kind of takes away a little bit from Tower Square as well as my building. So if there's any thought on, you know, who can kind of bid on that as well, like to run that cafe.
I'll let Tony maybe tackle a construction issue. I mean, construction's inevitable in any project, and I think most construction management crews now make a huge effort to make sure that on a daily basis all surrounding stakeholders are informed of the work that's going to happen that week. They do everything to do it within certain blocks of time. But you know, we'll of course do everything with all respect and regard for all of the people that live around the square. With regards to the cafe, are you saying that the cafe might compete with other cafes in the building?
Absolutely.
I would say to the contrary, that in actual fact they'll all it's called inertia.
Well,
more breeds more.
I'm not saying it's a bad idea.
Yeah,
come to the mic if you
but
want.
You know, more breeds more. So all of the cafe amenities in Bryant Park in New York, it's only brought more people, and those people use those cafes, but they also use all the existing restaurants and cafes too. So I would view it as a positive contributor.
Owners may want to actually run the cafe, is what I'm
saying. Oh well, I'm sure Tony will. Tony will.
Yeah.
Open all bids, right?
Yeah, we do have a working group addressing that, and you're welcome to talk after the program too about that, because we want that to be done properly and effectively and in an exciting manner. There's one in almost all parks mentioned by Mr. Corner. There is a type of outdoor cafe or flexible restaurant space that enlivens the space. In response to the other comment too about the maintenance and the ongoing activities, and I think you described them as sleeping guests. And you know, we do have a lot of lawyers in town, so we have to address that. But the DCA does a really good job with the Clean and Safe program, and we work very closely with DCA on this project. And we hope to have them engaged both in programming, maintenance of the space, and being fair to those who want to use it. It is public space. So we have to be very respectful with how we address issues that some may consider to be less attractive. But it is great public space that we have to maintain. When you program it, you make these improvements, I think you'll see people respect it as well. I had a conversation with someone at Discovery Green in Houston, a similar park project, and a police officer said, you know, it's interesting, once they improved the space, people felt like they cared about the space, and people who then use the space care about how they use it and take care of it. And you're a lot more proud of your space and your city when you do that. When you neglect it, you have less interest in how you maintain it. So that's very important. And Joe Marinucci is here, by the way, does a great job with that program, and I think we'll work very closely to make sure it's successful.
Thank you. Next question.
Mr. Corner, I want to compliment you on a...
Pull the mic up for you.
I want to compliment you on a very thoughtful presentation and plan, but I'd like to add a few words of concern or dissent. Ontario Street is one of the exceedingly few north-south spines in our downtown area that provide communication between the two freeways, basically. And if Captain America comes to town, or like tonight when the north lanes of East 9th are closed, there's even fewer. You're losing that communication. Superior is one of the exceedingly few east-west corridors that has a bridge to the west side where some of us happen to live. Wouldn't there be a way to retain, I don't know what the traffic studies have done, but it seems like you're trying to divert the traffic around the square, but instead of creating a wall of steel in the middle of the square, you're creating a wall of steel around the outside of the square. Wouldn't it be possible to close West and East 2nd Street, with the exception of the terminal quadrant, and accomplish much the same thing while retaining traffic on Superior and Ontario, except for public events or special occasions? And if it's probably beyond the description of what you were working on, but I've tried to engage people in the past on what I call the inner emerald necklace of Cleveland. If you look at that particular drawing and you look west toward the Rockefeller building, if we extended the mall at least to West 3rd Street or possibly beyond, you'd have a much greater public space, possibly with use underneath it if need be, but a much greater open space, green space, that would engender even much more development and growth. Thank you.
Well, good. Thank you. I agree with that. All I can say about the traffic is that if you remember the first three schemes we had four or five years ago, they were all trying to broach this question about streets. So one of the schemes kept Ontario and Superior open, another closed one of them, and another closed them both. And we used those with our traffic engineer, who's nationally renowned as being sort of state of the art with how they do this sort of traffic planning. And in their estimation, what we're doing is a good thing in terms of how traffic works in Cleveland. Because it's not only how traffic works around the square, it's also how traffic works several blocks either side of the square. So we feel pretty confident about the traffic planning. And also, we feel pretty confident about what we've now done to be able to create a great park. And I agree with your comment about extending the mall, but that's another $30, $50 million too. But maybe that's for tomorrow.
Your turn.
I think in this, going along the same thought, my question was that you've closed off Ontario, and I realize you've done a good job of trying to keep vehicular traffic out of on the Superior Link, but what about, I'd like you to comment a little about, since we only have one shot at doing this thing correctly, about closing that one off too. I realize that's going backwards a little bit in the design process, but I'd like to hear your thoughts about creating one big space rather than, and I know you've done a very good job of attempting, but it still is bringing vehicular traffic into a public space.
Again, I think when you think back to where we were 3, 4, 5 years ago, I mean, we were told you can't even move a curb, that this was all federally sponsored in transit investment, and we can't do anything. And so I think we've come a long way to do what we've done. I would say that if it's proven, when this is built, and if it's proven that Superior is either underachieving or is unnecessary, there's no reason why you couldn't adapt the park to a full 100% closure. But right now, at this point in time, this is where we are. And I think it's a pretty good solution given the kind of political and logistical complexity that we've faced.
I don't debate that. I would like to hear, though, your opinion as a designer. Which way would you rather see it go?
I mean, yeah, but I'm a designer and I have a multi-headed client.
I understand.
So
I understand that, but I'm still going to.
I think it's a worthwhile question. If I could throw you a lifeline here,
yeah.
I would say go back and look at the three original designs. And it was there's been a very, very thoughtful process, and I think. It's obviously you've said that leaving it this way, and if the road wants to be closed later, close it, and you know that's a possibility. Let's get the next comment or question.
Hi. Many of the projects that you showed us tonight from other cities, most notably the High Line, Millennium Park, the Sculpture Park in Seattle, really emphasize and feature public art, large-scale public art. And I was wondering if there's a consideration, especially working with Land Studio, for introducing some Cleveland art into what we see here.
I'm going to ask Anzola to say something to that. So she doesn't get off the hook. But I would say this, that when we designed the High Line, and we're also working on Seattle waterfront, the idea is that the programming entity afterwards seizes on all of the opportunities for artists to come in. So we found that rather than designating places for art and saying this one day will be where the sculpture will go or whatever, you design something, it has a sort of logic, a certain set of characteristics to it. And then in the next stage, the programming entity invites artists in to interpret how they would like to create an artwork in the context of that park.
So the artists are deciding for themselves where they see creative opportunities rather than a park planner trying to allocate space to that. And I think it works really well because the art program on the High Line has produced wonderful stuff that none of us could ever have imagined. And they've picked sites and locations and come up with things that we would never have thought of. So I view it that way, that we design a generous, open, stimulating environment where artists can come in and make their own interpretations and produce something great. I definitely do think artists should be involved in this, and I think that's part of the life of the park. And I would ask Anne to just maybe put an exclamation point on that.
Time, you said that very well, and that's actually part of what we were talking with your team about today. It is how we can incorporate temporary art, and the design is still in development, so we do think there'll be opportunities to incorporate different artistic expressions as the design evolves. But really the flexibility of the design we think will allow for a lot of opportunities going forward to do just what you said and what they've done on the High Line, create places where artists can have temporary installations so that is an element of the robust programming that we envision for the square. I think this is